Yorana et bienvenue à tous au 20e salon Lire en Polynésie de Papeete qui se déroule du 12 au 15 novembre 2020. Une 20e édition un peu particulière puisque les restrictions liées à l'épidémie de COVID-19 ont forcé ce salon à se réinventer et à être tenu entièrement en ligne. Vous pouvez retrouver le programme de ce salon sur lireenpolynésie.pf et sur les réseaux sociaux Lire en Polynésie. Aujourd'hui, nous avons le grand honneur de recevoir un grand parmi les grands. Écrivain maori remarquable et remarqué, Witi Himaira est le premier romancier maori à avoir été publié en 1972 avec Pounamou, suivi de Tangi l'année suivante et Fanao l'année d'après. Son travail a été ensuite récompensé à de multiples reprises. En 1987, il publie Pie the Whale Rider, qui sera son premier roman adapté ensuite au cinéma sous le titre de Whale Rider, réalisé par Nicky Caro. Depuis, trois de ses romans ont été adaptés, Kawa en 2010, White Lies en 2013 et Mahana en 2016. Par ailleurs, à l'issue de cette rencontre avec Witi Himaira, nous vous proposons de voir le film Mahana pour la première fois. En diffusion par accès libre sur Internet, en partenariat avec le FIFO et le Festival des Antipodes de Saint-Tropez. Mahana est inspiré du film Bulibasha, Kings of Gypsies, publié en 1994 et adapté en français par Auvent des Îles en 2009. Mais sans plus attendre, nous accueillons parmi nous en direct depuis Auckland à Aotearoa, Witi Himaira. Witi
Kia ora, Mareva. Nga mihi ki a koutou o ngā iwi o te Moana Nui a Kiwa, ki a tata Māohi o Tahiti. Nā reira, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā tata katoa. Good to be here.
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you very much for joining us on this 20th edition of the Papeete Book Fair, Lire en Polynésie. It is a real pleasure and a great honor to have you with us. As I told Siafigal yesterday, even if it's not in flesh and blood, at least it will be in spirit and soul.
Well, thank you. I only wish that I was with you because I am meeting whenever I'm there personally, physically, with all of my cousins and my aunties and my uncles and my mokopuna of the Pacific. And I'm really sorry, of course, that COVID-19 has spread throughout our world. And so we must keep each other safe, especially our older people, kuia and karawa, our elders, because they are the precious resource that we have for the future. And of course, our mokopuna, our grandchildren, are the ones who will walk into that future. So I hope that you're all feeling safe where you are.
Thank you very much. And likewise, we see we really wish that we could have welcomed you properly here in Tahiti. But well, it just means it'll be for another year.
Yes, well, Tahiti is always in my thoughts. I have just finished writing a book called Navigating the Stars, and the story of Navigating the Stars, which is about the myths and legends of that the Maori brought from Tahiti, actually. So the book actually starts in Tahiti, and I'm very, very proud to have just launched that book, Navigating the Stars, last week.
Okay, so we know that you have already participated in the Papeete Book Fair multiple times already, and you all also came in Tahiti to as a juror for the FIFO, the Oceanian International Film Festival. And but today, this year, you're here with us to talk about Bulibasha, King of Gypsies, and its adaptation to cinema with the film Mahana, directed by Lita Mahuri in 2016. Tonight will be the first time that it's going to be aired in Tahiti and available in French Polynesia. And so this is a wonderful occasion for us to have you with us, even if it's through a video conference. The book was first published in New Zealand in 1994, before being translated and published in French in 2009 by Auvent des Îles. And I read somewhere, or I heard it, that you wrote this book while you were in a writing residency in France, in Menton, in the south of France.
Yes, I did. I did. Normally, in those days when my father was still with me, my father would have come with me to Menton, where I was the Catherine Mansfield Fellow. But unfortunately, he was having a hip operation. So, you know, he had to stay at home. He didn't really want to stay at home at all. He wanted to go to La Belle France because he just loved French people. So I had to go by myself. And yes, I wrote the book in Menton, France. What happened was that I went to Nice with friends to get the carte de séjour. And on the way back, we passed these gypsies on the side of the road, and they were all having a caille or a meal. And I told William, stop. We must say hello to these people because they remind me of my own people back home in Aotearoa. So we stopped and we shared some kai with them. They were quite amazed, you know, that a stranger would just stop like that. And I was so thrilled to see them because they did remind me of my own people in New Zealand. And I was so thrilled to write the book about Maori in New Zealand, actually from the other side of the world.
Oh, okay. And that makes it clearer. How did you get into that residency in the first place?
The residency is a scholarship that is awarded by the New Zealand government every year for a New Zealand writer to go to France. And there is also a residency in New Zealand for a French writer to come to New Zealand to write. So for many, many years, we've had this tradition of writers going to France and then of writers from France coming to New Zealand. So I applied and I was very fortunate in that year to be awarded the scholarship. I have to say that I've always felt that the year in Menton was a turning point for me. It was the time when I was able to really create a new direction, a new journey for my work. And in fact, every year since then, I've managed to write perhaps one book a year, or else one play or one film or one opera or one theatre piece every year. So I actually think that I must have drunk something in the water when I was in Menton.
Yes, maybe it was the lemons.
Yes. Well, we have to be going over there for the 25th anniversary of the Menton Fellowship this year, but unfortunately COVID meant that I had to cancel out of that, and of course I had to cancel out of coming to Tahiti.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's totally understandable. In a lot of your novels, if not in all of them, family is a very important and recurring theme. It can be a central part of the story, like it is in Bulibasha or Pie, or more something in the background, as it is in Nights in the Gardens of Spain. But even when it seems to be in the background, it still supports a lot of the story and convey a meaningful part of the beauty of the book as it is unveiled through the narrative. Why is family so important to you as a writer?
Well, it will be the same, of course, for you in Polynesia, and that is that whānau, for us is very important. Iwi, or tribe, is important. Manaakitanga, or supporting each other, is important. Aroha is important, and you can't really write about the Polynesia or Māori without realizing that we have a whakapapa, that our whakapapa unites us through the ages and through the years and through generations and generations of family. So whenever I am writing my books, I'm always aware that the families in the front of the books are representing our history. So by writing about family and writing about the ways in which we relate as a family of grandmothers, I was brought up with many, many grandmothers, of grandfathers, of uncles, of aunties, of grandchildren. I am really writing the body Māori, the body Polynesia, the body politic of our people. The other thing is that, after all, I had such really wonderful relatives. You know, my grandmother was a very political person. And then when she died, my grand auntie took over my upbringing, and she also brought me up to believe in family. However, my mother, when I started to write about our family, she would say things to me, "Why are you always writing about us? Why don't you write about other people? Why don't you write about people who are rich? Or why don't you write about people, you know, who are who live in really nice houses? Why are you always writing about us? You know, we just, you know, we have nothing." And so I said to her, "Well, you know, Mum, you and Dad are the king and queen of my life. And my sisters and brothers are the princes and princesses of my life. And my iwi is my kingdom. And so even though you might not think that way, that's the way that I think." And so I write because it's an expression of my gratefulness for being part of a Polynesian family and a Polynesian tribal framework.
Okay. And do you think that it is also relevant or important as to addressing a Pākehā audience?
Well, my first audience is not a Pākehā audience. My first audience, of course, is my own people, just as your writers, they are writing for their own people. And, you know, I mean, you have such wonderful writers in French Polynesia. And when I was at FIFO, for instance, I was very, very excited to see that the writing was going into television and into film, and that your people were tackling really major issues like security issues throughout the Pacific, and were very, very concerned about nuclear testing in Micronesia and those big global issues. So in the future, that's where my work is going to be going as well. I really want to tackle issues like global warming, like rising of sea levels, like the continuing need for us to be very, very vigilant against great power activity in the Pacific. And I take off my hat to your own writers, especially in film, because they are leading the way.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you for that very inspiring statement. Another question about Bulibasha and Bahana as well. The action takes place in Hukareka, a fictional place that is, despite all, located in a real Aotearoa in the 50s. And I have two questions about that. Why and why? I mean, why a fictional place in a real setup, and why in the 50s?
Okay, so the book is about the competition between two villages. And so one of the villages, I've kept the real name, which is Waituhi, But they have a rivalry with another village that I called Hukareka. And the reason why I decided to create a different name for Hukareka was because if I used the real name, they might all get very angry with me and come after me with Taiaha and it poke it up my bum. So I preferred to not, you know, not make myself a moving target. Okay. So even now, you know, some of those people say, oh, so are we the Hukarekans? And we didn't lose that hockey game, you know, because we are, it's also about sporting rivalry. It's about multicultural activities and rivalry. And so I've always made Waituhi the winners, even though we weren't. So that is why Hukareka is an imaginary competitor village. Why the 1950s is because I am using my own life as the witness for Māori and the Māori journey, the Māori odyssey in New Zealand. And so I was growing up, I was that boy, Simeon, who was the main character of the book. And so I always felt that if I write my own life, then that validates and that authenticates the world because I've lived it. And so that's why the 1950s. So as I grow older, I still use myself as the primary witness. It's important for me to put, you know, myself in front of my work because then I become the leader for it, the standard bearer for it. I am honouring it. What is exciting is that even now, my ancestors keep on scraping my skull out. You know, they scrape, 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 and all of this stuff comes out. And I'm very, very fortunate that I'm still a contributor to the evolution of the Pacific story in New Zealand.
Okay. Also, do the chosen names of the characters and the places have any other relevance for the audience?
Well, yes. The grandmother, Ramona, is based on my grandmother, Teria. And in the movie, she's played by... Or who plays the grandmother? Nancy Brunning.
Yes.
Now, you know, the amazing thing about working with younger people is that you never really know what's going to happen. But 3 years ago, Nancy then wrote a play which she called Witi's Wahine. That's what she called the play. And the play has been an immense success in New Zealand, and it is about women in my work, including Ramona and Bulibasha. So it's now been performed for two seasons on the East Coast on various marae, because Nancy and I always want the work, first of all, to be seen by the people. But from that point, it then goes out into the wide world. As long as my work is always embedded in Māoriness and in Māoridom, then that's the first respect that I can give to it. And then where it goes from there is up to the gods. And so I'm hopeful that actually you might be able to see it over there where you are.
Yes, that's true. Along with the theme of the family, the women have a real and a strong status in your stories. And I didn't ask you any question about that, but maybe you can develop or explain something about that. I mean, for instance, in Parihaka, women play a central part in the story.
Yes, so I think it's different in Tahiti. I think that you all come from a matriarchal society, but in Aotearoa, our societies have been mainly patriarchal. And so the woman as a leader has had to have been an extraordinary accomplishment. So with the Parihaka woman, the main character for that is Erenora, and she and her sisters travel all throughout Aotearoa during the Māori Land Wars of 1860s, going to various prisons to find their husbands, including Erenora's husband, Horetana. But to do it, they have to dress as men, because otherwise they will never get anywhere going through that settler society. So that's one example. All of the women in Whale Rider, they affirm the young girl. Nanny Flowers affirms the young girl Pai Okahu in The Whale Rider. In White Lies, we have Paraiti, who is trying to save the people by being the only doctor that they have, because her practices have been outlawed by the Pākehā Society. So in every one of my novels or theatre pieces, the women in them are boundary breakers. They break boundaries, they transcend boundaries, and they do it because of the health of their people, because their people have to survive, and they have to carry the leadership.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Switching back to Mahana and the Bulibasha, how did you work with the filming team, and what was your role or your part in adapting the screenplay?
Yes, well, before I go there, I really have to say that women in the Pacific in your area are just amazing. A recent instance is the writer Celestine. Celestine has been writing a script for New Zealand's production about Tupaia, who was the navigator who came with Captain Cook to Aotearoa. So all of our, if we don't have writers like Celestine, if we don't have other writers like your wonderful Tahitian writers, then nobody's going to know. And so that was the reason why I wanted to write as well, to make sure that our memory carries on, and that the people in our lives are never, ever, ever forgotten. Mm-hmm. So your question about my relationship with the film, I was an associate producer for Bulibasha or Mahana, and I worked with my very good friend Robin Scholes, who was the creative executive producer for the film. She and I negotiated for Lee Tamahori, who's one of Māoridom's, as well as the world's best directors. And I guess that we're fortunate in New Zealand that we do have a film industry. I'm aware, for instance, that in your area, that film as an industry is not as able as it is in Aotearoa and Australia to produce films for your own people. But here in New Zealand, we are able to produce films for Māori. He is one. Then, of course, we have Taika Waititi, who's another major director, not just here in New Zealand, but throughout the world now. We have Nikki Caro, who, apart from directing The Whale Rider, has just completed directing Mulan. So all of these people, and we have also had Moana, and Rachel House, who is one of the actresses in White Lies, she supported and assisted in the writing of the script as well as Taika Waititi for Moana, which is the breakout hit around the Pacific in terms of film. So my success is built on the shoulders of being carried on the shoulders of others. But it is important for our people to upskill themselves so that they do get into production capability. Because without production capability, as you will know with your role in FIFO, you need someone who can get the money, you need someone who can choose the actors, you need somebody who can work on the locations, you need somebody who will bring in the infrastructure. And that's what I did with Bulibasha or Mahana.
Okay.
So another, if you are a writer, you can't just be a writer. You have to upskill your everything. And now, Robin Scholes and I are attempting to get a television series done on the Pacific, which we hope to call Ariki. And it will be about the Maori voyages from Raiatea.
Wow. When is it due?
Well, we've been working on it for around about 10 years now.
Yes, we're not in a hurry, I know.
But okay, that's okay, because the Whale Rider itself took us 8 years to get from script to screen. And Mahana also took 4 years. So these things take a long time.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it does. You're right. You've just talked about Taika Waititi and Nicky Caro and their success in Hollywood now. I also heard an interview of you back in 2018 for Hetohu, the program Hetohu, about the Treaty of Waitangi. Over the course of the interview, you said something about storytellers, and you said, "We define ourselves by the story we tell about ourselves." And earlier this year, so Taika Waititi, as he received the Oscar for the Best Adapted Screenplay for Jojo Rabbit, acknowledged the original storytellers and dedicated his award to all the indigenous kids who are the original storytellers. How do you feel about that? Honestly, as a Maori, as a writer, as a man, just a human being, maybe?
Well, I have grandchildren, and I want my grandchildren to grow up in a Maori world. I want them to grow up in a Maori world, and I want them to have all of the rights and privileges that other people have that have been denied them when the Treaty of Waitangi has not been honoured. I can see really good things happening because now we have a 120-person parliament, and of that 120 people, 40 of them are Maori or Pacific Islander, you know, which is pretty amazing, considering that when I was a young man, there were only four parliamentarians, but now we have 40. Apart from that, we have also got politicians who have come from Islamic ancestry and African ancestry. So New Zealand is changing. We have had at least 80 of our land claims considered, and that is because of the Treaty of Waitangi. If we didn't have the Treaty of Waitangi, then we wouldn't be able to do this. So my mother is right. She said to me when I was a young boy, we have to fight the law with the law. And so Māori are taking up the law to fight for their rights through the law courts. We still have, however, you know, once upon a time we were landless. Now we're houseless. We need more houses. We need safe houses. We need houses with good water. We need houses that are warm. We need houses that are built for whānau, not two or three bedroom houses, but we need big houses that accommodate our whānaus. We need to see less people in our prisons. There are too many of our people. Our statistics are really bad there. We have to get into health more and get health under control for Māori in New Zealand. We have the highest rates of heart disease in the world. We have terrible dental hygiene issues with too much sugar. We have real problems with diabetes. And so, you know, we must get our people onto the positive side of all the statistics. And this is where literature helps. And it's where film helps, because that's where our children are going. And it's also when they look at screens, we have to go where they are going, you know, to give them these positive messages about being who they are. So education is a very, very important tool. And getting our books into schools, you know, getting our films into schools, getting our people into schools. And the more that Māori can walk through the door of a school with their child, the easier it will be for that child to grow up knowing that they have been affirmed by their grandparents and affirmed by their culture.
Okay. Well, that's great. That's a very inspiring statement. I've been told that we're running a bit out of time. In a few words, the last word of this interview, what would be your message to the youngest people who are maybe hearing you or reading your books for the first time?
Okay, so my mother used to have a proverb which goes, te mokoko he kakata te kahikatea, which means that the caterpillar can gnaw its way through the kahikatea tree. And she always used to use that as an example of looking on the long term at the way in which we can achieve things. So all I can tell them is to keep on fighting, you know, to keep on making sure that they are tenacious, to make sure that they have stamina, because they have a world to save.
Yes. That's great. Thank you very much, Witty. It's been a lovely interview with you, and it's been really an honor to welcome you through the internet in this 20th edition of the Salon Lire en Polynésie. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So I'm just going to sing a quick waiata. E hara I te mea nui nai nei te aroha e. No nā tūpuna tuku iho, tuku iho e.
Thank you.